Our goal for today is to get to the root of the problem. Well, what do we mean? Well, roots are when we have something equaling zero. And one of the goals in mathematics is oftentimes to solve a problem, and that usually reduces down to saying, when does this particular expression equal zero? Sounds pretty easy. I mean, calculators do it all the time. But is it easy? Not really. It took a lot of time and methodology to develop the tools to do it. And today, we're going to talk about one method, which is based off of calculus, and it's called Newton's method. So, well, let's begin. So here's our basic idea. We're looking for the root. So again, some expression, we'll think of it as our function f of x, needs to equal zero. We say, well, where is it easy to solve? Because we always start off with an easy case. Something that's very easy to do are lines. We say, all right, well, it'd be easy to find a root of a tangent line. Okay, so what can we do? Well, so our goal here, we have this function that's marked here in blue. We want to find that point where we hit the x-axis, the root of our problem. We say, well, look, instead of trying to figure out what the function is doing, hard, we'll say the tangent line is acting like a good approximation to the function. So we're going to have the tangent line step in as a substitute. So let's follow the tangent line down. Now, you might say, well, what do you mean by following the tangent line down? Well, what really happens here is we're looking for a root. And we say, well, we don't know where it is, but we have a guess. It's not right, but it's probably not wrong to a large degree. It should be close. Close is good. So you have a guess. You say, all right, what we're going to do is we're going to use that guess to follow the tangent line down and get a better guess. Now you're probably saying, wait a second, that's still not the answer though, right? There's this gap. Well, what do you do? Well, now that you have a better guess, you can say, all right, well, let's repeat. So you go up again and you form a tangent line and then you get a better guess. And now you probably see where we're going. You keep doing better and better and better. And so you repeat this often enough and you get a pretty good approximation, at least assuming things are not too unwieldy. Some things can happen. We'll talk about things that can happen in just a second. All right, so how does this work? What's the methodology? Well, we know the formula for a tangent line. It has the following form. The y equals the value of the function plus the value of the derivative times x minus a. Now we're looking for the root. So we're going to take that and set it equal to 0. So we set y equal to 0. We're going to solve for x. So you do some things. You move the f of a across, divide by f prime of a, and then you add the a. And lo and behold, the root has this relatively nice form. A minus f of a divided by f prime of a. Now, in some sense, how do you think of this? Well, a, that's our current location, our current guess. And now we're going to say, all right, what happens? Well, f of a is sort of how far off the axis we are at that time. So in some sense, the further f of a is from zero, the worse. And then we say, okay, what's this divided by f prime of a? Well, that's how many steps it would take, in some sense, for us to get down to zero. So the larger f prime of a is, the faster we go to zero, and the smaller f prime of a is, the slower we go to zero. All right, so what's our technique? So we start with some initial guess. The closer, the better. Now, how do we get the initial guess? We can just start a wild number. Oftentimes, we have a reasonable idea. We say, well, it should be somewhere around 2 or 3. Another thing you can do is do a little bit of sampling. Now, one nice thing that we have is the intermediate value theorem, which we talked about before. So what we can do is we can say, well, we'll sample the number line. So maybe we'll just pick some points here. And what do we have? Well, maybe we have that our value of the function is positive, it's positive, then it was negative, and then negative. And then we say, aha, intermediate value theorem says, assuming we have a nice function, and nice here means continuous, but really when we're talking about Newton's method, nice really means differentiable. then we say, look, here there's got to be a root. So we've got to sort of narrow our search down to that spot. That's a reasonable place to find the root. Okay, so do a little bit of sampling. Look for possibly where we change signs between two consecutive sample points. That's where we know a root should be, somewhere around there. And there's where we make our first guess. Now we have a guess. We want to make better guesses. So we're going to set up our formula, which says, see, our initial guess we called x sub 0. 0 indicating our initial guess. We're going to create a sequence of guesses, x sub 1, x sub 2, so forth and so on. Each one a little bit better than the one before. And we apply the formula. So the xn plus 1, that would be where our tangent line hits the x-axis, is equal to, and then we plug xn into that expression, xn minus f of xn over f prime of xn. Now we make a guess, then another guess, then another guess, then another guess, da 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 da. Now, when do we stop? Well, we're not going to stop at the root. This is one thing we're going to talk about. Newton's method doesn't find the root. Newton's method is about finding really good approximations to the root and getting better and better approximations. So when we stop, simply comes down to a choice of, well, what are we satisfied with? Oftentimes we're like, well, let's just take so many steps, maybe 3 or 4 steps. Or we say, well, let's go until the start of it. So if we think of it as a long number, maybe say, well, look, the first 10 digits aren't changing. So that's pretty good. And that's good enough for the approximation that we want. So we'll stop there. Things like that. So that's generally what we have. We need to have some reason to stop. And it depends on context and what we're trying to do. All right. Let's talk about some things to keep in mind. We already said this. We'll say it again. We aren't finding the root. We're finding good approximations to the root. So if you're after the exact value of the root, you're going to have to look somewhere else. But I'll warn you, it's hard to find the exact value of roots. Very, very hard. Even polynomials, once you get past fourth degree polynomials, it's hard to find the exact value for roots. So keep in mind, we're looking for approximations. Now, sometimes it can be the case that we might have multiple roots. So we might have a function. So here's our line, and we have our function. And lo and behold, it crosses at multiple locations. Now, maybe it's the case that we're after a particular root. So we could say, hey, what's going on? I want to find this root here. This is my goal, is to find that root, or at least find a good approximation to it. But Newton's method, if you don't start near that root, you start somewhere else, it might somehow end up saying, ah, this is where I might end up. So how do you avoid that? Well, the moral is, if you really are looking for some root at a near specific value, start as close as you reasonably can to that specific value. And otherwise, you might end up going too far away. Another thing to note is that this is a highly computational thing. In other words, this is a great time to use calculators if you're going to go more than 3 or 4 steps. And so you might say, well, why do it? Well, we're doing the idea. The idea is so beautiful. And it's good to understand what the calculator is doing. Now, this is not the only technique. Calculators and computers have other techniques, but it's nice to know, look, it's not a black box that can never be understood. There's a methodology in play. So keep in mind, you might want to have a calculator nearby. Now, another word of warning. Occasionally, things can go really bad. What do we mean by that? Well, your root might do things which are very, very bad. What? Well, maybe this is our goal. So let's go back here. So suppose this was our goal. We said, well, let's make this our guess. All right. Now you can kind of see what's going to happen here. If I make this my guess, what do you notice? I'm at a point where my derivative is very small. And I'm kind of far off the axis, so what's going to happen is it's going to shoot me way, way, way far away. And so if you choose a place where your derivative is close to zero, it'll shoot you far away. Other things that can happen is you can apply this procedure on any function, right? And so you can apply it for a function which may have no root at all. So for instance, you could say, here's x squared plus 1. And now it'll just sort of bounce around, move around all over the place, because it really can't get close to a root. There is no root for this function. So be careful, be careful. You might say here, the root is a repeated root. Well, what does that mean? Well, that's an example of that here. Repeated root means something like y equals x cubed. Now, what happens? Well, what happens is the function x cubed, it's actually very shallow near its root at zero. And so, as a consequence, when you apply this procedure, it does go to the right root, but not very quickly. And that's because you're having very, very slow convergence. It's best to experiment. And of course, this is something easy to experiment with. Now, you will see most of the problems that involve Noonan's method tend to involve polynomials. That's because those are the things that we can compute with. But one thing to keep in mind, you don't have to do polynomials. Indeed, any nice function can be used. And nice, in this context, means you can take a derivative. It's differentiable. So suppose you take the function f of x equals x minus cosine x, and you want to find a root. All right, so that's where x minus cosine x equals 0. In other words, what are we looking for? Well, we're really looking for a number where what's true? Well, if x minus cosine x equals 0, it really says x equals cosine x. So in other words, it's a number that when you plug it into the cosine function, you get back the number you started with. Kind of an interesting number. So what does Noonan's method say? It says, well, take the next guess is the current guess minus the function at your current guess, okay, xn minus cosine of xn, over the derivative of your function. 1, because derivative of x is 1, derivative of cosine is negative sine. So there's a minus, that's why you get a plus, plus sine of xn. Now we start the process. And this is one where you definitely want a calculator, because you're going to have to compute some rather strange values. So you say, okay, first guess was 0. Second guess, you can almost do that by hand. 1. Well, that's not so hard to see. You have sine of 0 is 0, cosine of 0 is 1, and these are zeros, so you end up with 1. Okay, that's easy enough. But again, the next one, 0.75, no, you wouldn't get that. That's why you really need a calculator. And what do you see? Well, you see it's converging relatively quickly. In fact, look at x5 and x6. It looks like they're identical. Well, of course, they look identical, but that's because the difference is occurring further back here. So we see it started to stabilize at the start. So we can now say with pretty high confidence that the number we're looking for looks like 0.73908513321151. And that's oftentimes about as many digits as we can put into our calculator. So we say, great, good, there we go. That's our good answer. And notice how quickly it converged. Indeed, even after 4 steps, we already were up to, how many digits is that? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 digits. Amazing. Amazing. Wow. So, what do we see? Well, okay, it can converge quickly. Now, I will say, I've mentioned this before, that you can actually do this problem, find when is there a number, when you plug into cosine, you get that number back out by taking the following. You take your calculator and you just keep pushing cosine. So what that does is it feeds cosine back into itself. So you put the answer back into the function over and over again. And if you're patient, it goes to the same value. But you have to be patient. Why? Well, it starts similar, 0, 1, but pretty soon you'll see it's not converging very quickly. In fact, after pushing the button 50 times, what do you see? Well, it agrees to a degree, right? 0.7390851 3. That's as far as it goes. This is now, this on the end, not right. Not yet. You'd have to keep pushing the cosine button for quite a while to get it to work. So this shows you that there is power in using different tools and using better tools. It's not just about finding the right answer. It's about finding the right answer in a reasonably fast and efficient way. Because we don't want to wait around for a long time. We have stuff to do. We're busy people. All right, well, I guess it's time for us to do a little bit of practice. So let's get to work.